What happens to our health when we cut back on salt? Scientists tried to address this question in a recent clinical trial using two different interventions. They followed 1,600 people living in 48 retirement homes for a period of 2 years. The first intervention was a salt replacement. So the regular salt, the sodium chloride, was swapped with a substitute that is about 25% potassium chloride. It also contains some flavorings like mushroom, lemon, and seaweed that make up about 10%. And the remaining 60% or so is regular sodium chloride. And the other one, the second intervention, was just a straight reduction. So trying to gradually reduce salt consumption without any replacement. In the first intervention, the swap, the folks receiving the salt substitute saw a reduction in their blood pressure. Systolic blood pressure, which is the higher value in your reading, came down by an average of 7 points, 7 millimeters mercury, and diastolic blood pressure, which is the lower value, came down by 2 points. The estimated amount of sodium and potassium they consumed from salt also changed. Potassium went up, sodium came down, as expected. And their serum levels, the levels in the blood, also changed. Potassium went up and sodium came down, although the 24-hour urine excretion, the amount of sodium and potassium in the urine, potassium went up, but sodium, there was no significant change. So the average potassium level, the levels in the blood of the participants receiving the salt substitute went up. More people had high potassium than in the control group that received regular salt. High potassium level is called hyperkalemia, and less people had low potassium, what's called hypokalemia. Now, whenever they detected somebody with hyperkalemia, with high potassium level, they stopped the substitute for that individual. So this is one potential caveat of these salt substitutes. People sometimes with some health issues, like chronic kidney disease, for example, can have a harder time eliminating potassium, and it can accumulate in the blood, and its levels can rise. So if you have kidney disease, please talk to your doctor before starting a potassium salt. Another thing to bear in mind in these discussions is the reduction of blood pressure brought by these salt substitutes can also have a protective effect on the kidney and the heart. So this has to be weighed against the risk of hyperkalemia. So it really has to be case by case for these individuals with special issues. And another thing to bear in mind is some medications can raise potassium level. So some blood pressure lowering meds, for example, can do this. So if you're on blood pressure lowering meds, also talk to your doctor before you start a potassium salt. Now, in this trial, the patients who had high potassium, hyperkalemia, did not have a significant increase in adverse outcomes like cardiovascular events or kidney issues. And there's another trial from a couple years ago, large trial that we've talked about previously, that also used salt substitutes, potassium salts, and also didn't see adverse outcomes linked to hyperkalemia. So this is reassuring, but it's worth bearing in mind these caveats. On the other hand, when it comes to sodium levels in the blood, although people receiving the substitute had an average lower sodium, they didn't see an increase in cases of hyponatremia. So hyponatremia means sodium is too low. So it seems their sodium levels were lower, but still within the normal range. All of this is interesting, but the most interesting part of the trial were the actual cardiovascular outcomes, things like heart attacks and strokes. People receiving the salt substitute had 34% less combined cardiovascular events, heart attacks, strokes, heart failure, or cardiovascular death, all combined. Cardiovascular deaths alone were lower by 36%, and there was a lower number of total deaths, 16% lower, although this difference did not reach statistical significance. Just a quick parenthesis on this question of the total mortality, the all-cause mortality, because a lot of you guys have asked me to talk about this and have asked me if this is the most important outcome we should be looking for, maybe the only result that matters. I agree that mortality outcomes are relevant, are interesting, but we have to be really careful with mortality because this gets misinterpreted on social media all the time. You'll see people saying things like, there was no significant reduction of total mortality in this intervention, so that means they were dying more of something else, so that they were still dying on the exact same day. You'll hear even doctors say this. This is a huge logical leap. If there's no significant difference in all-cause mortality, it could mean that the intervention doesn't affect risk of death, or it could mean that it does affect it, but the trial fails to pick it up. There's a fundamental concept in clinical trial design called statistical power that has to do with the scale of a trial and the ability to detect a certain outcome. So if you're looking for something like a biomarker change, like change in blood pressure or cholesterol levels, yeah, you can see that in weeks, maybe even days. If you're looking for a difference in number of heart attacks, that's going to take much longer to detect after the intervention is initiated. If you're looking for a change in mortality, longer still, right? I think this is obvious. Now, this idea of statistical power matters for all outcomes, actually, but we need to be especially careful with mortality outcomes because they take the longest and they require the most statistical power. As an example, that other trial looking at salt substitutes from a couple of years back, they looked at 20,000 people, not 1,600 like this one, and they followed them for almost 5 years, not 2 years. And they saw lower blood pressure, lower risk of events, as this one did, but they also saw significant reduction in total mortality. So it's completely possible that this trial sees no significant change in total deaths because of a lack of statistical power. We'll touch on this topic again in the future. Just wanted to leave you guys with this nugget that the duration of the trial matters, the scale, the size of a trial matters. We have to look at all of these characteristics. We don't just jump to a conclusion from a sentence in the summary of the trial. Oh, one last thing before we continue looking at the results. Why doesn't every trial just look at 1 million people over 10 years or 50 years? Depends what the investigators are interested in. Trials are designed with specific outcomes in mind, specific goals. There's primary outcomes, there's secondary outcomes. Just like we talked about in the example, it could be blood pressure, it could be heart attacks, it could be deaths. And the size and the length of a trial and which population you look at is always going to reflect those goals. Okay, so that's the first intervention, the salt swap. Lower blood pressure, lower cardiovascular events, maybe even lower cardiovascular deaths. What about the second intervention, the salt reduction? The goal with that one was to achieve a 5 to 10% reduction in salt intake every 3 months, and by the end of the 2 years, to reach a 40% reduction. And nothing happened. Their estimated salt intake was not significantly different from the controls that did not shoot for a reduction. Their serum levels of potassium and sodium, their urinary excretion levels, nothing was significantly different. The investigators explain that the participants could tell that their salt was being cut back. Not exactly mind-blowing, I guess. And at least some of them added some table salt to their food to top it up. So the actual estimated intake of sodium and potassium from salt didn't significantly change. And accordingly, blood pressure was not significantly different over the course of the 2 years. And predictably, cardiovascular events and mortality outcomes, no significant difference there as well. So this second intervention was basically a big flop. The replacement was much more effective. It doesn't mean that salt reduction can't work for anyone. Some people get it to work and stick to it long term, and we have trials reducing salt and seeing changes in blood pressure. But for this population specifically, in this trial, it was not effective. This is relevant for public health and for guidelines that often recommend moderating or reducing salt without talking about replacements, knowing that at least in some populations, that advice might not stick because people can't comply. In terms of limitations of this trial, one is the population. They're all elderly people living in retirement homes. We've talked about the adherence issues. And another caveat is this trial is what's called cluster randomized. So they didn't randomize people. They randomized the retirement homes between reduction or not, or swap or not. So there are some caveats with that design as well. So the trial does find benefits of replacement. Now, the participants had an average blood pressure of 137 over 80 at baseline right before the trial started, and 62% had a history of hypertension. So one reasonable question is, maybe only people who already have high blood pressure benefit from these replacements. So they separated out all the participants who had a blood pressure of under 140 over 90 before the trial, and it turned out to be about 600 people out of the 1,600. And in this subset of people, the average blood pressure was 122 over 74, so decent. And among this subset of participants, those assigned to the salt substitute had lower blood pressure average by the end of the trial than those receiving the regular salt, 100% sodium chloride. They also had 40% lower risk of developing hypertension, starting blood pressure meds, or having a cardiovascular event all combined. Now, interestingly, they did not see a higher risk of hypotension, of low blood pressure in these people. Because we might worry that they already have blood pressures that are much lower, that are decent, normal, or close to normal. And maybe by using these salt swaps, maybe we're going to push them too low. So episodes of hypotension, of low blood pressure, were not significantly different between the two groups, people assigned to the replacement salt or regular salt. So it looks like the replacement salt in this group didn't so much push their blood pressure even lower. What it did was prevent the rise seen in the control group receiving the regular salt. This is interesting because blood pressure lowering meds can sometimes have a hypotensive effect. It's one of the potential side effects, pushing blood pressure too low. And it looks like these salt substitutes don't have that downside. Another interesting thing about this trial is they looked at their results as a function of physical activity, which is a common question. So people who exercise never or only occasionally saw a 54% reduction in hypertension, starting blood pressure meds, or having a cardiovascular event, all combined. Whereas for those who exercised often or daily, the reduction was 32%, but it didn't reach statistical significance. So no significant reduction. Now, we have to be careful because the difference between these two groups was also not statistically significant. So we can't say that they're actually different, but it's a possibility that people who exercise often benefit less. If this is confirmed later on, it wouldn't be mind-blowing because people who exercise regularly tend to have lower blood pressure, so there would be less room for improvement from a salt swap. So overall, the evidence for salt substitutes with some potassium chloride seems quite promising. They help prevent the development of hypertension for people who already have high blood pressure. They help lower that a bit and prevent actual cardiovascular events. So these salt substitutes can be another tool in our toolkit in addition to all the other healthy lifestyle measures. Before we wrap up, I just want to touch quickly on another common question. This issue of, is it the sodium? Is it the potassium? Is it both? Is it the ratio? So I've talked to nephrologists and kidney physiology researchers about this. There is some debate among these scientists. It's not completely settled. We know potassium plays a role, so it's clearly not all on sodium. We also have many trials looking at just salt reductions without swapping for potassium salts and seeing blood pressure come down. So sodium clearly seems to play a role as well. It's not all potassium. So they both seem to matter, or maybe it's this ratio between the two. Now, the beauty of this topic of the salt and the blood pressure is how easy this is to test on an individual basis, because some people are more salt sensitive than others. Some people can consume more salt and still have great blood pressures, and other people need to be stricter. And these population studies are crucial and they're great, but they can't tell you where you fall in the distribution. So I highly recommend everybody have a blood pressure device with the cuff at home. You can get it for $20 and you can measure it as many times as you want, several times a day if you want, for free, painless, not invasive. And you can play with these factors, you can play with your diet, you can play with these salt substitutes if you choose to do so. And you can see exactly what effect this has on your blood pressure. Okay, last thing I want to touch on is another caveat pertaining to salt, and that is iodine. Regular salt is often iodized and is actually one of the main sources of iodine in the diet of Westerners, especially people who don't consume a lot of fish and seafood, which is most Westerners. Milk is another common source of iodine in Western diets. So if you're going to cut back on regular salt, consider this aspect of iodine. Look for a substitute that is iodized or seek alternative dietary sources or a supplement. Do you know what the best exercise is to lower blood pressure? We covered it in this video. You're never going to guess what the number one was. And here's more on salt substitutes, including that large trial that lowered total deaths. Check those out. I'll see you over there.